So in the previous video, we took a look at what it would mean to execute a program on this computer. And we wrote this program that says to load data into the A register from whatever's in memory address 14, which was a 28, and then add the contents of whatever's in memory address 15, which is the number 14 to that, and then output the result. So it's outputting the result of those two numbers added together. And we saw that each of these instructions is actually made up of several different steps. And each of these steps is called a microinstruction. And we actually stepped through this program by manually setting the control words, each of these control signals, to either high or low. So in this case, we've got it set to A out and output register in, which will take the contents of the A register and put it into the output, which is the last microinstruction for the output instruction. And so the way this would work is we would go through each microinstruction and set up the control word appropriately and then pulse the clock. And so when the clock pulses, that's when that transfer actually happens. And so what the control logic that we're going to build here needs to do is to be able to set up the control word appropriately for each of these microinstructions between each of the clock pulses. So there's two things that we need to know in order to set up the control word appropriately for each microinstruction. One of them is which instruction we're executing, so load A14, and then the other is which step we're on. And actually, we don't even need to know what instruction we're executing until we get down to this fourth step, because the first three steps, you'll see, are the same for every instruction, because that's what actually loads fetches the instruction from memory and puts it into the instruction register. And then when we get down here to the fourth step, fifth step, and in some cases a sixth step here, then we need to know what instruction we're executing, but we'll have that in the instruction register that whole time. So we have that information. But the other piece of information we need in order to know exactly how to set up the control word is which step we're on. So step 0, step 1, step 2, 3, 4, and so on. And so to do that, we're going to need a separate counter that we'll build for the control logic to count which step we're on. Then we get to the end, we'll reset it and count again. So to keep track of what microinstruction we're on in our instruction cycle, I'm going to use the 74LS161, which is a 4-bit counter. And we use this in the program counter of the computer as well. But it's got the clock input and then four outputs, which will count in binary from 0 to 15. So this will let us have up to 16 microinstructions in each instruction cycle, which will be more than enough to handle any of the instructions we're going to build for this computer. So here's the 74LS161. So I'll just add this down here as the first part of our control logic. And I'll connect power and ground. And then pin 1 is a clear line, so we don't want the chip to clear, so we'll just tie that high, which will keep it from resetting to 0. And then pin 9 is a load, which is also active low, so I'll tie that to high as well, and that'll prevent it from loading in a different value from these inputs. And then we're just going to leave these inputs disconnected because we're not going to use those. So I'll tie the load high so it's not loading. And then pin 7 and pin 10 are enable lines, and so we also want to tie both of those high so that the outputs are enabled. So with all that out of the way, we now have our outputs and our clock. So as we pulse the clock, the outputs should count. So let's hook up some LEDs to these outputs so we can see that. So I've just hooked up the first three because I don't think we're going to need to count all the way to 16 with this. 8 is actually going to be more than enough. So 3 bits will be enough for that. And so now I'll just hook the clock up to the computer's clock and see if this counts. So the clock input is pin 2 here. And it's probably bouncing a little bit there, but if I start the computer clock, we'll see it starts to count in binary. And so here you can see as the computer clock is pulsing, the counter down here is counting away. And so that will count and keep track of where we are in our microinstruction. So if it's 0, we're here, 1, 2, 3, 4, and so on. And if we don't need to use all of the cycles here, we can just do nothing for the last few. But you might remember in the last video when we were stepping through this by hand, what I would do is I would set up the control word and then pulse the clock, and then set up the control word for the next microinstruction and then pulse the clock. And so really what we want is we want the control unit to be changing the control word between clock cycles. And right now this is changing on the same clock cycle that would be changing everything else. And so we almost want two clocks that stay in sync, but where the control logic is updating just before the main clock is pulsing. And the way we can do that is actually just by inverting the main clock. So conveniently, as part of our clock logic, we have a 74LS04, which is an inverter, and it's actually six inverters, and we're only using, I think, two of them. So there's a spare inverter up here that we can use to invert the clock. So we'll take the output of the clock into one of the inverters here, and then if we look at the output of that inverter, I'll just hook an LED up here. You can see that if you think about when the LED turns on, this one turns on, then this one turns on, then this one turns on. And that's perfect for what we want to do with the control logic, right? Because we want the control logic to set up when this one turns on, and then we want the computer to actually execute that step when this one turns on, and then we want to go back and forth and back and forth. So by inverting the clock, that'll give us another clock that is perfect for what we want to do with the control logic. So I'll go ahead and connect this inverted clock down to the microinstruction counter in the control logic. And so you can see now this is counting, but it's counting between the clock cycles. Actually, I'll move this LED down here so it's easier to see. And so now you can see these clocks are alternating, and this one is updating sort of between these clock pulses, if that makes sense. Now, in addition to counting and having a binary representation of which microinstruction we're on, it's also going to be useful to decode that. And so I'm going to use a 74LS138. That's going to decode it so that we can take that 3-bit binary value and translate that into having a separate signal that indicates whether, you know, which of the instructions we're on, or which of the microinstructions we're on. So I have a 74LS138, hook up ground and power. And then this has several enable lines. So these two are active low, and then there's one that's active high. And all of those have to be set properly for it to be enabled. So we'll set these two, or tie these two to ground and tie this one high. Pin 4 and 5 to ground, and then pin 6 is high. And then the input is this select A, B, and C. So that'll go to the 3 bits here that we're using to count. So there we go, we've got our select there, and then our outputs are just going to be here along the top. So 0 through 6, and then 7 is down here on the bottom. So I'll just hook up some LEDs so we can see what's going on with those. And so I've just hooked up the first 6, but you can see that as this counts, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and then 6 and 7, if I had those LEDs hooked up, you see this counts along, and we'll keep track of which of the microinstructions we're on. So if we're executing one of these instructions, if we need to know, if our logic is going to need to know which of these steps we're on, we've broken that out now, and we have a separate signal that tells us we're on each of those steps. The other thing we can do is we can use one of these outputs to reset the counter, because right now, this is the counter is counting up to 8. Actually, it's counting to 16, but we don't have the fourth LED hooked up, and this is only decoding 3 bits. But if we want to reset it, like let's say we want to reset it when it gets here, instead of counting 6 and 7, go back to 0. So it's going 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And that time that it's spending on 6 and 7 are really just kind of wasted. The computer's not going to be doing anything. So it'd be nice if we could just reset this counter and get back to 0 as soon as it gets up to 6. And so we can do that by, instead of tying the reset here of the 74LS161, which is pin 1, is this clear pin, instead of tying that to 5 volts all the time, so it's never resetting, we could tie that to one of these outputs. So let me take this out and tie this over here to, I'm going to tie it to the last output. Well, to this output here. So I've tied it to output 5 here, and so what's happening is it's going 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, and then when it gets to 5, this is actually going low, although you can't see it, because the instant it goes low, that resets the counter, and the counter goes back to 0. So it goes 0, 1, 2, 3, so 0, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and then 0 again, because as soon as it hits 5, it resets and goes to 0. And so now, this is only counting up to 5. It's going 0, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. So it's not really only counting to 4. So we're only getting essentially 5 steps out of this, 0 through 4. And then it immediately resets. So that actually wouldn't work in this case because add has 6 steps, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. But of course we can move this over to this last pin, which I don't have an LED hooked to, but is the next output. And so now you can see, as soon as it gets to the end, it resets. And so this is counting, you know, 0 through 5, it's counting 6 steps. which is the most that we'll need for any of the instructions that I'm planning on. And so now the combination of having this counter here that shows us which instruction or which part of the instruction cycle we're on, along with having the instruction itself that gets loaded here into the instruction register, we've got all the information we need to properly set the control word bits. And so really the only missing piece is some combinational logic. And you could, I've got a video where I talk about how you can replace any combinational logic with an EEPROM. And so hopefully if you watch that video, you can imagine how you could use some EEPROMs to take this counter information and this instruction itself as inputs to the address lines of the EEPROM, and then the data outputs of the EEPROMs could directly feed the control word over here. And just by programming the right things into that EEPROM, you can create whatever instructions you want to for this computer, and the computer will be done. Now, I'm planning to do something a little bit more sophisticated over the next couple of videos to talk about how you can write microcode, and so essentially a little bit nicer way of organizing the control logic. But just to kind of get a sense of how this could work, the fetch cycle for each of these instructions is the same. And so really for these first three steps, it doesn't matter what's in the control or what's in the instruction here because we haven't actually loaded that instruction yet. But these first three steps are going to be the same. And so we could build some very simple logic to just look at what step we're on and turn on the appropriate control signals. And so I want to just demonstrate that right now. So for example, the first instruction or the first micro instruction in the instruction cycle for every instruction is counter out memory address register in step. And so that happens at sort of time T0. And so we can give each of these steps a name. So T0, T1, T2, T3, T4, and T5. And so this T0 step for every instruction is going to be counter out memory address register in. So we can actually hook this signal here, which is T0, straight up to those signals there. Of course, we need to invert it because this signal that we've got here is the inverse of T0. It's the T0 complement. So we can just stick an inverter in here. And again, this is just kind of an example, a demo. This isn't how I'm going to actually build this control logic, but just to demonstrate, we can hook an inverter up here and we can take the T0 signal or the complement of the T0 signal into the inverter. And then the output of that inverter, if we just stick an LED here, oops, my power was not hooked up quite right. There we go. And so now you can see the LED comes on whenever we're in T0. And so when we're in T0, that's when we really want the counter out and memory address register in signals to be active. And so instead of this LED here, I could just come out of this inverter and go into the counter out, wherever that is, that's over here. Let me turn these other things off here first. We can say counter out. And so you can see on T0 now the counter out signal is active. Let's get that label there. So counter out is now active on T0. And then we also want, memory address register in, which is over here. So maybe what I'll do, pull that out, bring this here, and then just jump over from memory address register in over to counter out, wherever it is. There we go. And so this is just kind of a temporary thing to demonstrate this, but you can see now on time T0, we've got the counter out and memory address register in active at the same time. And so that's T0. So this is T0 here, this first step. T1 is RAM out and instruction register in. And in the comments on the last video, a lot of people pointed out that you could probably do the counter enable, which increments the counter, the same time that you do the RAM out and the instruction register in, because those things are not related. And I agree, we could actually do that. And then this would actually become T1 to do all three of these things. And that actually saves us a step, right? So instead of needing, for example, for this add 15, instead of needing 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 steps, we could do it in 5 because this would be a single step. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And actually that also reduces the total number of instructions that any instruction the computer would need. So this is a really good optimization. So let's give it a try. Let's say for time T1, we're gonna do RAM out, instruction register in, and counter enable. So again, we'll need to go through this inverter, right? So T1 here will go into the inverter. And then coming out of the inverter, We want to go to RAM out, which is here, as well as instruction register in, which is here, and counter enable over here. And so now you can see for time T0, we get our memory in and counter out. And then for time T1, we get RAM out, instruction register in, and counter enable. If we watch the operation of the computer now, you can see at T0 and T1, we're setting the control word, and we're actually moving things around. So you can see that the program counter is incrementing here. You can see that that program counter is making its way over into the memory address register. And if we speed up the clock a bit, that'll happen even faster. And you can see it's also starting to fetch things from memory and put them into the instruction register. And a lot of memory doesn't have anything in it, but once we get to an area of memory that has some things, you can see those things are getting moved into the instruction register for each of the instructions. So I'll slow it down here. And so now you can see that instruction is sitting here for, so we load a new instruction, but then for time 2, 3, 4, and 5, that instruction is sitting here in the instruction register so that we could build some logic here that looks at the instruction that we've loaded, as well as what part of the instruction cycle we're on, so we know which micro instruction to actually set. And so I'll get into that in future videos where we'll talk about how to actually build this logic. You know, of course, this inverter here, this is all just kind of temporary just to demonstrate the fetch part of executing a program. So if we speed this up again, you can see we're going through memory and loading those instructions one at a time into here to execute each instruction. So this is just temporary. In future videos, we'll use the EEPROMs to basically implement a combinational logic, but I'm going to do something a little bit fancier to kind of organize the way that the EEPROMs are programmed a little bit better so that it's easier to do the sort of microprogramming, which is writing these micro instructions to define what instructions the computer actually is able to interpret. Now, one other nice thing about combining the RAM out, instruction register in, and the counter enable into a single step is that instead of, you know, I think add 15 is our most complex instruction with 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 micro instructions. But if we combine this, it's only 5 micro instructions. And if that's the most complex instruction that we have in the computer, we don't need all 6 steps here. We can actually reset the counter at T4 by moving this over here. And so now when it gets to T4, it resets. And that actually makes all of our instructions execute faster because they take 5 steps instead of 6 steps. And so that 6th step would make it, you know, 20%, make each instruction take 20% longer. So this is a really nice optimization to combine those things. And I think we can then just get rid of that extra step.